Good afternoon. We're going to take a slightly different turn now, and we're going to look at the memory of plants. We're all familiar with our memories and how we document our memories through pictures, through books, through creative work, artist paintings. But plants also document their time and their life. And what's amazing about plants is that they have a much longer memory than we do. We're constrained in many ways by our own longevities. Plants can live thousands of years, and you can see this plant is actively, as Shannon, who helped me put this together, my PhD student said, this plant is photobombing this picture. I think my clicker is broken. It's not working. Thanks. There we go. The amazing thing about the world that we live in, when we take a picture or a snapshot, we're freezing time. But time isn't static, and plants record the dynamic nature of the world that we live in. And this is Altgeld Hall through its many seasons. When I take students into the woodlots here on campus, I tell them, look around you. What you're seeing is today. Tomorrow it will look different. Next year it will look different. 20 years ago it was different. Plants don't stay still. They grow and they move, but they do it at such a slow pace that we don't actually perceive it. We don't watch the grass grow. But if you walk into a woodlot, there are babies, there are adults, there are plants and vines climbing. Things are dynamic and they're always moving and changing. We have our snapshots. And here are many snapshots from my photo album. That's me, and that's me today. That's my mom and I. We change and we can document that change. That's Shannon, my PhD student, with my daughter when my daughter was smaller. Now my daughter's taller. We change. This is my family. We can go to the same spot on the Earth's surface, and we can recreate a memory. We can recreate time. Plants aren't as mobile, they're trapped. So while we are constrained by our longevity, we are not constrained by our mobility. We can take our memories with us, we can create new memories in new spaces. Plants, for most of their life, are static in place, not in time. So the only time plants are mobile is when they're setting seed, and we'll come back to that. Plants document their own lives, but we also document plants' lives. The picture on the left is a painting by an Italian artist by the name of Arcimboldo. He painted this in the 1500s, and it's a mythical god of the harvest. If you look at that painting and you think about Italy, Milan in particular, in the 1500s, this would give us a really good picture of the plants that would be growing there, because that would be what he would be using in his painting. There's something missing from this painting. If we think about Italian food today, think about pasta, think about pizza. The key ingredient, if you're going to make an Italian meal, would be a tomato. There are no tomatoes in this picture, because tomatoes were introduced to Europe around the time that Arcimboldo was painting this picture, from the Andes in South America. Tomatoes didn't go into cultivation until the 1800s in Europe. So the memory that we have, if we go on a trip to Europe, if we go on a trip to Italy, we have very vivid tactile memories of that experience. And to go back to one of the speakers earlier, it's a false memory. It's something that we have put in place. The tomato is not native to Italy. We have put it there. It is what we call in the plant world an exotic invasive. We're helping it invade. This picture here is of a villa from 2,000 years ago in Italy. It's the dining room of that villa, and painted in the frescoes around the walls, it's four walls, 360 degrees, are 24 species of plants that we have been able to document their existence 2,000 years ago because of this picture. so we can put together a memory of the Mediterranean region from that time. But plants also leave memories. And these pollen down here, and we're all familiar with pollen because we love them so, they make us sneeze. These pollen are breadcrumbs that are left behind by the plants. They get trapped in sediments. Those sediments, they get trapped in the water. They get tied up with sediments in streams and rivers. They get carried to lakes and wetlands, and there they get stored. And they get stored for thousands of years. And we can go back and get them and get a story from them. We can capture those memories, and we'll come back to that. We're very good at documenting local change. We're very good at understanding our landscape in our own backyard. This is a nature preserve that's just west of us here, called the Nachusa Grasslands. It's a nature conservancy holding. My PhD student is working there. And when we go into the forest, even though I can tell my students that the forests are changing all the time and that what you see today isn't what you would have seen tomorrow or what you wouldn't have seen yesterday and not what you would see tomorrow, it's still really hard for us to imagine that. So here's the woodland today, nice and dense, full of trees. There it is in 1939. This is something that we go to every day, but we don't see the past. But the past is recorded. We can record it, but we can also get the information from the trees because we can find out how old they are. We can look at their growth rates using things called tree rings, and most people are familiar with tree rings, and we'll come back to that. If we jump from local to global, we look at where plants live across the world, and we're all familiar with the green, which is the tropical rainforest. If you look at where we live here in the Great Lakes region, we live on the boundary between the deciduous forests, the plants that lose their leaves every year, and the tall grasses of the prairies. We live right on that margin. We have a line here, as if you could be standing in the forest one day and jump over into the grassland. It doesn't happen that way, right? It's more dynamic than that. And the memory of those margins and those boundaries are imprinted in the soil, they're imprinted in the pollen that's left behind, so we can capture those memories and we can document change. But this is static. We live by this, and we think this is where the tropical rainforest is. End of story. But this is not where the tropical rainforest has always been. The dark, the black areas on this map represent tropical rainforest 50 million years ago in the Eocene. And the Eocene climate is actually the climate that we are predicting to be in about 200 years, given the changes that we know are occurring on our landscape or in our environment. This is a time when the world was still, the world as we know it, the continent was still breaking up. So look at India. What's India doing down there? It's about to smash into Europe and form the Himalayas. It hasn't done it yet. But before it did that, tropical rainforest dominated the globe. And Antarctica down here was covered in what we call a nothofagus or a southern beach forest. This is a southern beach forest. This individual is several thousand years old, growing in southern Australia. That is the forest of Antarctica 50 million years ago. That is what it looked like. And we know it doesn't look like that today. Our memories are static. Our memories are constrained. But the plants can tell us a much longer story, and we hope to we can learn from them, and that's a little bit of what I want to share with you today. These are the pollens that I was referring to. This is, we call, if you flip this one upside down, it looks like Mickey Mouse. Usually very easy to pick out. What we can do is we take a core, a sediment core, deep down into a lake, and what we find is we pull the sediment core up, and we slice it up, and then we take each little slice, and we pull the pollen out of it. And then we can reconstruct what the forest would have looked like. We use the breadcrumbs, we use the plant's memories to reconstruct the forest through time. This graph, while it looks complicated, basically we're going back 15,000 years. We look at the pollen here, and then the pollen shifts through time. So we're going up, here's present. We go from a conifer forest. This is here in Illinois. This is Nelson Lake Marsh, just over there. It was a conifer forest 15,000 years ago. It switches to an oak forest, and then more recently to a grassland. So we can document the memories and use those memories to understand how things change through time and how the plants are responding to their environment. We can take those pollen cores, which are spatially isolated, right? We have one core from one marsh, and what's that telling us about the entire globe or the entire continent? Not much. But when we can take a core from every marsh and wetland and lake across the country and put them together like a jigsaw puzzle, we begin to see that when we were covered in ice, the vegetation communities, so this dark area here is spruce forests, this dark area here are oak forests represented by pollen, and we can watch those vegetation communities march their way across North America as the ice melts. We can use that breadcrumb trail. Okay, so we can go from massive glacier and the forest constricted to what is today Florida to what we would expect to see today. We can take that knowledge, we can take those pollen cores, and we can create our own memory of what it would have been like 16,000 years ago in LaSalle County here in Illinois. And this is exactly what it would look like. Conifers, wetlands, crazy animals that don't exist here anymore, and these are mostly from fossils. In fact, back here, this is a massive giant beaver, which doesn't exist anymore. But this is all these plants we know. We know they existed. We know the proportions that they existed on the landscape because of the information we can get from the pollen they've left behind, the snapshots in time, the family photo album, in essence. What we can do is we can take those pollen cores and we can map when did, this is hickory, when did hickory arrive at this point in the pollen cores? When did it arrive here? When did it arrive here? And we can actually calculate not just where they were, when they were, but how fast they got there, how long it took them to travel, how long it took them to migrate, how many thousands of years it took hickory to get from here to there. We can see it took about 6,000 years, okay, to march its way across North America. Plants don't pick up their roots and walk, right? They're not actually migrating. What they're doing is they're setting seed, and that seed is being picked up by a squirrel, it's being stashed somewhere, it's being forgotten about, and then it grows, okay? But to be this big, or to be this big, you have to be this big first. So you have to survive as a seedling before you can be a tree. So this is a very slow process, a very slow process of change. This equates to about 20 kilometers per century. I'll say that again. 20 kilometers per century. That's it. They are not moving quickly. What we know from all the data that we've collected, and this is the most recent data from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So this is 60, 70,000 papers worth of information. We know that climate's shifting. We know that the last 30 years, ending in about 2012, was the warmest 30 years in the last 1,400 years. So, okay, climate's changing. What does that mean for the plant community? It means that what we go out and see in the woodlot today is not going to be what we see when we go out into the woodlot in 2080. It's not going to be what we see in the woodlot in 2200, right? It's changing, fine. The rate of change is the issue. It's changing much faster than it has changed in the past. And think about it. If I'm saying that the climate is going to be changing dramatically by the time 2080 hits, that's not even 100 years, and plants are only moving 20 kilometers a century, they're not going to be able to move as quickly as the climate is shifting. That's a whole nother talk for another time. To be able to gauge this, because I don't think of myself at the end of my lifespan, right? But I'm only going to live for so long. I'm probably not going to be alive in 2080. So to create 2080, to find out what the seedlings are going to be doing, we got National Science Foundation funding to take 2080 to the forest. So that's what you're seeing behind you here. My research collaborator and I basically took heaters, so we're up on the east shore of Lake Superior. We take our electricity in, which is a story in itself, into the forest. We set up these heaters, we plug them in, we water them, we water the seedlings, we keep them warm for 3 years, and then we look and monitor and see how they're doing. These are the kinds of studies that are going on to take plants' memories from the past, use the information we can get from them, create the future, and see how they would respond. This is the area that I was talking about where we were. This is the point where we're going to be expecting to see that change, right? If we're going from one community to the next, that's going to be, this is the deciduous forest, this is the coniferous forest. These guys are the ones that are now migrating and marching forward, right? So that's where we should see the change. In fact, in this area here on the east shore of Lake Superior, you can hug a sugar maple, give it a kiss, and keep walking north, and know that was the last one you will see. But that's today, right? Tomorrow will be a different story. We use tree rings to help us create these memories, because tree rings record the environment. They record how happy a tree is in any given year. Lots of water, lots of sunshine, good nutrients. I'm going to grow fast, and I'm going to put down a really big ring. Okay, so we can record how happy our trees are. This is a tree core outside of Fermilab, and it's actually recording the history of particle physics in tree rings. So here we have the discovery of the electron in 1897, and the electron and the discovery of the proton in 1911. Okay, so we can create and superimpose our memories on the tree's memories. If we plug all this information into some models, everything we know from the memories of the trees, everything that we can gather, and we know where we're going in terms of our environmental change, we can recreate today. So this is sugar maples, where sugar maples grow in North America. And then we can put it in 2080. And in 2080, Vermont will no longer be the king of maple syrup. Sugar maples will not be growing in Vermont. And that's within at least your kids' lifetime. And hopefully most of you, maybe, I don't know. Yeah, most of you should be. So no more sugar maples. Regenerating, they'll still be there. This is the problem. They live 400 years. They're still going to be hanging out in the canopy. We're thinking, no problem. There they are. Look for these guys. If you don't see these guys, they're not going to be there. The next generation's not coming. Around here, the state tree of Illinois is white oak. White oak is nice and dominant in Illinois. Put it in the future model. Oops. We're going to have a new state tree. The trees are also whispering to us on a shorter time scale. When we think about the seasons and we think about the blooms and the blossoms of spring, we think about the grape harvest, if you care about wine like I do. These tell us, we know the durations of the season. We know where they're getting longer. We know when spring is occurring earlier. We know where fall is happening later. So they're whispering to us, and they're telling us things. We can track a field through the seasons, and this is the end of the season. Can you go to the previous slide for me? No? What you can see, if you watch this forest through the seasons, you see it flush in the spring, you see it get really green in the summer, and then you see the leaves drop off. The timing of all those events are key to the future, and it's the whispering. That's what the trees are whispering to us. That's what they're telling us. If they could tell us a story, we have to listen. This tree is a tree in England. It's an oak tree sitting in a field near my mother's house. This tree is over 100 years old. Go back 100 years in time, we're on the dawn of World War I. Who's walking past this tree and what stories are they telling? They have their memories. They're in their family's photo albums. At the same time, this tree is collecting its own memories. It's monitoring its own world and creating its own pictures and snapshots. If we're willing to listen to what the plants tell us, they can literally turn our world upside down. Thank you.